Here we go, we're back for another episode of your celestial one-stop shop for all things sevens, the seventh wonder of the podcasting world. We're nipping across, we're going transatlantic once again to bring you someone from the razzmatazz of the NFL. Yeah, that's right. Former England seven star Alex Gray is in town. He's worn the jersey of the Falcons, both sides of the pond, Newcastle and Atlanta. And now he's here in seventh heaven with myself, Burnsy, Chip, and Mitch, and we are ready to rumble.
We are ready to rumble.
Woo! All right.
Burnsy, it's funny that obviously we've all known each other now for quite a long time, and I think the pods really brought us close. But we only found out how old you are the other day, and me and Chip were a bit taken aback.
I was. I felt like you should have asked my parents before taking me out.
Although, to be fair, with that beard you're sporting now, it kind of makes sense.
The beard is significant.
For those who aren't watching the clips of this, it's a David Brent touch of ginger with a slight hint of grey at the bottom.
And he's sculpted the chin strap around the side, so he's shaved in the chin strap, which is a terrible look mostly. But Burns is doing all right.
My jaw's never looked so defined. Speaking of birthdays and age, how was the big bash? How was the big 3-0 last week, Chip? I saw you partying on your own in a barn with a bunch of skinny lagers.
Yeah, no, it was good. Annika made a hell of an effort and basically built me a bar in the barn. I had like a little shindig, me, Annika's mum, a couple of beers. Skinny Lager sent us out some beers, so some guilt-free beers on there. Thanks very much. Plug. No, it was nice. Just like a chilled out day, really. Bit surreal not seeing everyone, but I had a lot of nice messages and really felt the love last week. So yeah, it was a really good birthday.
Can you tell us the message that you got from an account that you've never heard of before wishing you happy birthday as well, Chip?
Which one? I can't remember now. Oh, the one who said, happy birthday to the head guard. Oh, cheers.
Your legend grows, Chippy.
Cheers. You know you've made it.
Are we allowed to talk about the New England kit? Or can I talk? I'll share my views on the New England kit.
I think we can acknowledge that it's changed to Umbro because it's out there. You wanted to tiptoe around this too much.
There's been some top quality social media on that. I love the one of all the Manx outside singing Stone Roses, dancing around with the long trench coats on.
If anyone hasn't gone to the replies to the tweet that England Rugby put out announcing the Umbro sponsorship, it's well worth a read scrolling down. There was some gold. My favourite one was some guy was just like, great, my son's crying. Thanks a lot.
That's class.
Speaking of stash, you did something pretty cool with your kit last week, Mitch.
Yeah, well, I've been doing my full kit Fridays, which is partly therapy for myself because just to remind myself that I used to play rugby. And it's a bit of fun. But then last week, the one that I dug out was actually from the 2013 World Cup. And it was, at the time, just got it signed by all the lads that played in that team. So managed to auction that off, actually, make a bit of money for charity, which is good. All round, that was a good little outcome from that one. And there'll be another one coming out this week. I haven't decided which one I'm going to bust out yet. Which one would you like to see?
You went big early. You went with the Tequila Sunrise jersey. You just get like, I mean, how do you follow that?
Mate, I honestly blew it too early, didn't I?
Don't bring that up. Still absolutely man down about that jersey.
You know, Chippy didn't, you know the story behind Chippy not possessing one of those jerseys?
No.
Despite wearing one.
Made my debut in that jersey. I scored my first try in it. And then after the tournament, it was the end of the season. It was Edinburgh, the last leg. And Will Beeley, who's the manager, like looked after all the kit, goes, give me your orange shirt. And I was like, what? like after the tournament, because I was a fresh pants, didn't know anything about it, took my shirt off me. He said, oh, we're taking the name off it, taking the number off, because they're going to use all the shirts for the Euros. So basically, for my debut, I only got the white shirt. I didn't get to keep the tequila sunrise. Gone.
Oh.
But because of fresh pants, I didn't question it. I was like, oh yeah, that must just be what everyone does. Like, everyone else was like, no, I'm keeping it. I was like, oh, okay. In full kit back. Gutted. Absolutely gutted.
Of all the shirts as well.
What a bad egg. Did he not know it was your debut?
Yeah, well, it was the first time I'd seen him. So yeah, he must have known.
He just knew that was one shirt he was going to be able to get back because everyone else was just going to keep hold of it. He thought, oh, I'll prey on the young guy. He weren't any better.
I wouldn't fit in it now, to be honest.
Mate, it's hanging up in his downstairs bathroom as we speak, probably.
Pride of place, Will Bealey, absolute bandit. Now, he was a good lad. He's just a bit tight when he would kit.
Yeah, so what happens to your kit every time you play a tournament? Do you get to keep the full kit every time you play?
Yeah, so we get you get a kit for each tournament, basically. And then sometimes like they use socks again, but majority of the time you just get to keep that kit, yeah. So match shorts are the one that just get going, aren't it, Mitch? No one keeps them, really. They're the ones that you like give away because what you're going to do with like 40-odd pairs of white shorts?
Yeah, we've been lucky in the men's squad that we've had quite a big kit allocation from certainly since we've been with Canterbury. And the women's is slightly different. They don't get as much kit, which is something that I'm sure will be addressed in the coming years. Yeah, it has changed, hasn't it? And yeah, so it's quite cool because it's nice being able to give bits and bobs of kit away, like the shorts and the socks. To be fair, the shorts and socks are in a bad way after the end of a tournament. You can imagine the sweat and the dirt.
Yours are the skid marks.
That's Nortzes with the skid marks.
Yeah, that's his nickname, isn't it? Skid mark.
So that was quite a big thing, giving away that World Cup jersey. I think that's so generous. Like, there's no way I'd part with that.
I mean, we make bad decisions in lockdown and maybe I'll be regretting it now. I don't know. No, it's the thing is, mate, like I'm quite sentimental with a lot of my kit. I like to hold on to it and I've kind of held on to quite a lot over the years. But to be honest, if there's a better use of it in the short term, so be it. Maybe one day I'll look back and think, oh, I wish I still had hold of that shirt. But I've got the memories, Burnsy, so.
As long as you keep hold of a couple, I'm the same as you, Mitch. I'm like a hoarder with shirts. I don't like giving them away. But as soon as a decent charity pops up or a school asks you for an auction, then you've got to do the right thing, haven't you? Because what are you going to do with another shirt in the bag?
It's only just, you know, going to be sat in a bag or sat in a drawer somewhere and there's some that I'd never give away, to be fair. God, Chip, what shirts would you never give away? Have you got any of that?
Commonwealth Games, the kit for that. Cape Town Sevens, I'd never give that one away. And I think my Worcester Warriors, the Premiership, my first Premiership start, that one, I'd keep that one as well. What about you, Burnsy? Dubai Invitational?
Have you still got your Dubai Invitational shirt?
I've got both of them, actually. Both of them, because we had a home and away. That's how seriously we took it. Yeah, I've got my Dubai Invitational. Don't have a Richmond jersey.
Not even a casual one?
No.
So you actually had the playing jersey. I thought you were just the supporters jersey. Can you join in then, Burnsy, and do my full kit Friday with me this week? Put your UR7 stash on, your Wanderer stash.
My Wanderer stash. I don't have the shorts anymore. The shorts are too small at the time and they're even smaller now. But do you know, speaking of Umbro, I've got an old school London Irish jersey from when I played mini rugby. I don't know if you guys will remember it, but it had a big L and an I down one side of the shirt. So it's completely green, made of highly flammable polyester, and then had an L and an I, and that was made by Umbro. It's an all-time. It's the best kit in Premiership history. Got some breaking news on Twitter, boys. The England Sevens fans have been compiling their team of the decade, and they picked the coach yesterday. Simon Amor got the nod, and the number one jersey has been up for grabs. It was a close run thing between our very own Chippy and Damu Damu. And Chippy has edged him out by just 3 votes to make the England 7 fans team of the decade.
I voted for Damu Damu because they tagged me in it and I was like, there's no way I should be in a team ahead of Damu Damu. He was one of the best players I've ever seen. Thanks very much for the love. I would have been happy to ride the bench behind Damu Damu, who's an absolute athlete. But yeah, good to know I've done something all right. The head guard lives on.
Career highlight for you there, Chip.
Yeah, being out Sam Edgley and Jeff Williams as well.
Unlucky Jay Doobs and little Sam Edge. Sam Edge is one of the only players I've ever played with that's triple dummy switched me with one movement. So me in Tokyo one year, he's running across. I've come on the switch. I guess still in the 15s mindset, dummied me. I was like, oh, I best get with him again. Dummy switched me again. And then dummy switched me again and run into touch. I was like, right, this is what Sevens is about then.
Right, so who's done their homework on today's guest and sport?
It's fair to say I'm not an expert on the NFL, but I will be pretending I am for the next period of time.
Yeah, I don't have a clue either. Whenever he speaks to me about stuff, I understand what he's saying because he explains it well. But yeah, NFL's just totally over my head.
So you didn't watch Any Given Sunday like I did yesterday in preparation?
Is that your favourite NFL movie or American football movie? Because mine is Remember the Titans. It's like one of my favourite films of all time.
Remember the Titans is deep. I mean, that touches the soul, but Any Given Sunday, that's like the razzmatazz of the NFL, isn't it? That's the pyrotechnics. That's the stuff that I love.
Do you think you're sunshine, Mitch?
Yeah.
Is Jerry Maguire? That's American football, isn't it?
Jerry Maguire is a movie. Yeah, the Show Me the Money scene is one of the best ever.
That's what Reece Mitch's agents does when he goes in.
Show me the
Balls
money.
Into Adidas. Show me the money.
Show me the money. So time for today's special guest. Super pumped to have this guy. And he made his debut for England Sevens at Dubai in 2013, aged 22. But come 2017, he piqued the interest of the NFL and signed for the Atlanta Falcons, where he has been learning his American football craft, putting in some graft and making waves in gridiron across the pond. We are lucky to have today in Seventh Heaven, Alex Gray.
To Atlanta where the players play, and we ride on them things like every day. Big beats hit streets, see gangsters roaming, and parties don't stop till 8 in the morning.
Welcome to Atlanta where the players play, and we ride on
the things. Alex Gray in the clouds, welcome to Seventh Heaven.
Thanks for having me, guys. I tell you what, it's a little funny being on the webcam with my clothes on for the first time, so a little different. You guys have done quite a few now, haven't you? You're getting good at it.
We're getting there. We waited until we got good to get you on, Shag.
Yeah. But you couldn't get Wadey on the bill, so that's why I'm on here.
They want him.
But I spoke to Dazza Fern yesterday and he said that you were that you've been down in the dumps because Marcus got the nod before you.
Oh, Steven. I mean, Marcus is all right, but McConaughey, fuck.
McConaughey wasn't on as a player, though. He'd won a competition as one of the super fans.
Yeah, sounds about right. Same at the Olympics, wasn't it, for him?
I'll tell you what, this is going to be a hot episode, Shaggy. Keep bringing this sort of heat.
What have you been getting on with then, Shaggy?
Nothing, mate, just trying to survive, you know, day to day. Stuck up here in London and can't get back to the US. All the flights are locked down and trying to stay healthy, fit. You know?
What's the story then? You able to do much training at the moment? Because you must, obviously, you've got to try and stay in some decent nick.
Yeah, classic. Yeah, it's same as everyone. A lot of running in the park, running routes in the park. And I'm sure there's been a few funny looks being like, what the hell is this guy doing? Especially since I've been full pads and helmet.
No.
Even I wouldn't do that. Jeez.
Are you fully invested in the word route then? You haven't gone route.
I'm sorry. Yeah, it's route. It's Z. Because all the guys, you have different positions and they all have different names like Y, X. Instead of being obviously Z for us, they all call it Z. So I can't shake it now. I'm just seeing words on a piece of paper when I close my eyes, and that's just what it is. But that's the thing, they can't understand you unless you use their lingo. You know what I mean? So you'll say something to them two or three times, And it's just easier if you just come down to their level, really. So,
did they give you a lot of stick in the beginning? Come down to. Did they give you a lot of stick in the beginning about your accent and stuff? Or does that still happen?
Yeah, you still get a bit of that. It's. I mean, I had one guy ask me, "Do they speak English in England?" Which almost broke me. Middle of training camp. Morale's running low as it is, just trying to get through the days. And some guy comes and asks you that, you're thinking, "Well, what am I doing, man?"
What's your crack now, then, Shaggy? What's the plan post COVID? Back to the States?
So the position I'm in at the minute is I've hit free agency. So I did 3 years with the Falcons. As it does in the NFL, you'll find there's so much more chopping and changing of teams and squads because the reality is everyone's on a day to day rolling contract kind of. So I managed to do 3 years with the Falcons, which was good. You know, did the first year on the pathway, signed another year's deal and signed a 2 year deal. And then after my first year of that 2 year deal, they said, "No, thanks, mate." So that's what happens. Like, I mean, even our starting tight end ended up in free agency, because they weren't going to be able to pay him enough money. So you find that quite a lot as well. You know, the guys at the bottom of the roster, there's a lot of chopping and changing, but if the team has no money to spend and you're one of the best players who's going to demand a high fee, you could get the chop as well. Like a couple of our starters got put on free agency but it's been a weird one, obviously, with, you know, the COVID, because teams can't do medicals. They can't bring you in for interviews. They can't do, you know, I can't do anything. I can't even be in the States right now. So it's just a funny time, but no one really knows when it's going to kick off again. So you just got to stay ready, y'all. You know what I mean? As they say.
So, but what's the point in signing a 2 year contract if after a year they turn around and say no thanks?
It's basically so they've got all the power, you know? So if you have a really good year, that second year, they can't, you know, you could be, say, if you sign, you know, a minimum contract, whatever it is, you know, $1 million, but then you absolutely ball out. A team might want to give you 5-6 million just on the off chance, but this team's like, "Nah, actually, you're on the same money, pal." So that's how they do it. I mean, they're just trying to keep you locked down, you know?
We haven't spoken about this for a while, lads, but that's how the contracts work on Seventh Heaven. So just stay on your game, yeah?
I wish, Benzie. So what's that like?
Match fees for you two, isn't it?
We all get an individual share of nothing.
That's why that's why we're trying to rack up the episodes. We get appearance bonuses on the pod. So what's that like, though? I mean, obviously, like, there's a degree of uncertainty in any sport. Like rugby, it's the same with injuries and stuff, but at least you know that you're sort of looked after for the period of your contract. What's that like going the day to day, especially someone like you who's super competitive and wants to do well? Like, what's that like in your being in that environment where it is so cutthroat? Because you hear about this all the time, like, you know, a kicker misses a kick and that's it, they get binned off or something.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen it happen. You know, you could be sat next to a guy and all of a sudden, a couple hours time, you come back from lunch and someone else is sat there. You know, it's just like, it really is crazy. You know, you come in the locker room every morning and you're just wondering, is there going to be a scout stood by my locker, you know, asking me to bring my iPad up to see the coach? The coach wants to speak to you, you know? Because it happened to one of our tight ends in our playing group. So we were in preseason and we were just sat having a meeting. We'd already practiced, had training, we'd come in, we were starting our like 8 hour slog of meetings, and scout knocks on the door, comes in, "Oh, can we have so-and-so?" And everyone just looks at each other like, "Oh, okay." Anyway, he goes off. 5 minutes later, comes back like really shook up, and he just said, "Listen, lads, they've traded me to the Patriots." So, I mean, better than being cut, but he'd just bought a house. You know, he'd played on the team for the 2 years before that. It's just how it goes, you know. It really is business first, and I think that's the difference between the American sports I've experienced rugby, where there is that kind of family feel a little bit, and you would hang out with guys and go for coffee and do all that stuff. But in the NFL, it is very much, this is your job. You either get it done or we'll get someone else who will, which is, it's a tough place to live, because, you know, every day matters. You know, it doesn't matter if you're the top earning player who they need on a Sunday to score the winning touchdown or throw the winning pass. They are always, every day, looking for someone to replace you. You know, they're always trying to, because there's a whole department, you know, they call it the front office. You have the coaching staff and you have the front office, and it's the front office's job to put the players in the building. And, you know, they make they make, you know, no secret that they're looking for people to replace you. And you see the guys that they bring in, you know, they bring the guys in to come in to try out, and they like run them through all drills and stuff. And then you see them hanging around getting some lunch before they go home. And you're looking, trying to size them up to see if any of them are playing tight end. But it was good. I mean, as you say, like, it really does bring out the competitor in you, you know, because everything is scrutinized. You cannot hide. You know, there's no taking like a rest in a ruck or anything like that. It's you versus him. Who wins? Do you do a good enough job to stop the quarterback getting sacked, or like, do you catch the pass, or do you drop it? And if you have one or two bad days, you know, the reality is you could be gone. Like, I've known guys who've had kids, they're doing absolutely fine, like doing well in training, but the kicker gets injured at the weekend and they need another kicker. So they cut this guy who's just had a baby the week before, and he's now jobless on the street, you know? So it's, you got to develop some kind of like mental dog about you, I'd say, because it is so cutthroat, but it is what it is. It's high risk, high reward with that business, you know? So
is there any like mental support? Like, you know, when we were at the Sevens, like we like speak to Katie Warriner, and you like, you got the boys to kind of fall back on. You said, like, obviously there's not a massive like team, as a bigger team feel in NFL, but is there any like support network you can lean on?
It's limited. I mean, because it really is. If you don't want to do it, someone else will. You know, I mean, it's on you as a professional to facilitate that yourself. You know, you have to turn up to work ready to go. You know, if you can't get that done, then that's on you. Sorry, you're gone. So it is somewhere that I really think that could be improved. But so many people come in and out of the team like every year that it's just hard to get any rhythm. Like, I know we had with the Sevens, you know, we had a lot of stuff that we live by and a lot of mental processes that you guys all try and buy into, you know. But with a squad of 60 guys, half of that team will change every year, maybe more. It's hard to get that continuity, you know what I mean? So it would be nice for the players to get a bit more of that, for sure, because it's tough. But at least all those guys that do come into the league, they have the fallback of the college. You know, they've all been to college, they've all got a degree, so they're not just thrown out on the street as you see sometimes in rugby a little bit.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Like, that's really good insight. So some of that you talked about, like the day-to-day and the feeling of having to go in day-to-day and do your stuff. Can you just give us a bit of an idea of what the day looks like? So is there a pretty standard kind of formula to the day, and kind of how does that work?
The kind of the way the week works is most football is played on a Sunday. And then what you'll do is, you know, you might be, this is kind of, you never stay over on away games. You always just leave the stadium, get on a flight, come back.
No social.
No social, yeah. Social,
what about the court session? Court session after
no
the
court sessions.
No court
nobody session. Nobody is socializing with anybody. I'm telling you that right now. You're in the building too much for guys to want to be hanging out together.
Are you sure that's right? Because I watched Any Given Sunday yesterday, and Steaming Willie Beeman, LL Cool J, they are having it off.
Yeah, I mean, you could switch in and watch ballers, and you think all the players on their days off are down in Miami. I'm sure there's a lot of that going on, because you have to remember, some of those guys, you know, and this is what I was warned about when I first entered the league, be careful who you hang around with, because some of those guys have no limits on their life. You know, if they want to get a helicopter to down to Miami Beach or whatever, they can just do it. You know what I mean? On their day off. Like, it's just, they can do whatever they want. So yeah, I mean, you can watch ballers and all that type of stuff, and it doesn't really, I'm sure that stuff is what happens in the off season. Well, I know it does, but when you're in during season, it really isn't like that. It's long days. You train for 2 hours, you're in the gym for 1 hour, the rest of the day is you're sat in meetings looking at film and doing all, and you're in from 7 to 11 some days, you know. So on a Wednesday, Wednesday's our main day. So you play Sunday, you come in on a Monday to do a lift and review the game. It's either a morgue if you've lost, or it's the best place to be if you've won. And so then you do that. And then you have Tuesday off, but Tuesday isn't really an off day for the younger guys. Like, you are expected to be in there in the recovery room looking at film. So Tuesday isn't really a day off. You know, you got to be in there. And then Wednesday's the main day. Wednesday's the day the pads come on. So the day would look like you'd probably get in for like 7:30 and have your breakfast. You'd lift weights at 8. And then at 9, you'll start your meeting. So you'll have what we call installs. So you'll start going through the plays that we're going to use for the week. And the installs are split. So you do a lot, some of them on Wednesday, some of them on Thursday, some of them on Friday. And most of them have been pre-learned, and there just might be some tweaks going on with the defense that we're facing. So yeah, you do those meetings up till about 12, then you have 2 hours of practice, then you probably have an hour of recovery, and then you have a bit of food. So then from like 5 till 8 or 9, or for the younger guys, sometimes later, you'll be in meetings looking at stuff and reviewing the training, and because there's so many different teams within the team. You know, there's the offense, there's the defense, there's a special team. So you spend all your time with your position group. So you have position group meetings, you have your offense meeting, you have your special teams meeting, you have your team meeting twice a day, you know, so everything's doubled up. But it's, you know, it's what you got to do if you want to be there, you know.
Oh, that's brutal, Shag. So obviously we know that Burnsy would be on special teams water boy. But where would you slot me and Mitch in if we had to come over?
Chippy, I think I would put you at linebacker. I think I'm kind of regretting playing tight end because you have to know so much. You know, playing defense, you just have to see the ball, run to the ball, and smack someone. So I think that's just you down to tee in it, mate.
Yeah, I'll tell you that, mate. Sounds...
Mitch, I mean, it depends which way you wanted to go. I mean, obviously, you'd fit into the quarterback, that kind of dictator role, you know. Or if you wanted the easy life, you could be the kicker or the punter. So
the fuck, he gets sacked straight away, mate. I thought you said they get sacked if they miss one.
Oh, I was waiting for you to jump in, Chip.
He had to get one back there.
I like being the kicker, Shaq, because I won't get hit that way, will I? In theory.
Yeah, life's easy for you as well, mate. No meetings, just playing table tennis all day.
Mate, how do they be the punter? How do they get away with it? Do they must get mugged off by the boys the whole time for having that cruisy life?
Well, you say that, but I think it's just they get respect because of how high pressure their job is. They have one job, and it has to be perfect. And as you said, like you miss two kicks, maybe if you're a young guy without a good record, they're probably looking for somebody else. You know what I mean?
So yeah, it's pressure.
You want to be a punter. That's what you want to be. Because as long as you can just put the ball in the air, make it hang for 5-6 seconds, kick it 60 yards, that's it really, mate. Like, decent. Yeah.
I got rocket boot, Shag.
That's it, mate. Get paid a milli a year for that, minimum.
I'll send you my highlights. I'll have to take a pay cut to come over then.
It sounds super regimented then, Shaq, like your day-to-day, but also, I guess, to some extent, the way you play. Like, as you say, you run the routes that are kind of cool on the play.
The routes.
I'm getting into the lingo now.
Look at you trying to get a contract already.
But, like, when you played sevens and we were playing together, part of your, well, a massive strength of yours was kind of your freedom, the creativity you brought to the game, and the way you kind of played, I guess, off script, should we say. How are you able to kind of put that into what seems like quite a regimented game?
Yeah, I mean, that's exactly it. It's like a chess game in your one piece. You have to be doing your job because there's all sorts of things to take into account, like quarterback timing. You know, if you're not where you're supposed to be, you could be closing up the space for somebody else. It's just, it really is like high IQ chess game. Because the coaching is crazy. You know, there's someone sat up in the booth, the offensive coordinator, who's seeing everything. He's seeing how deep the defenses are being run. He's trying. Each team is trying to outsmart each other, and it really is. There is very, very little. It's based far more on athleticism. You know, can you go above someone and catch the ball? You know, fully extended. Can you? I guess the little bit of thing you get is when you release for your routes, which is, you know, when you see when the ball goes set hut, you have a guy stood over you, and how would you lose him from the start? You know, you see a lot of wide receivers who are really good at that. You know, the guys with the really good feet. Apart from that, you know, you're there to do a job within a system. There is very little flair, I would say, because they want someone who can contribute to what they're trying to achieve on the whole. So yeah, and I, you know, as you say, that's something I find really hard, is having to, you know, wait around for someone to say go, and then be so prescribed with everything you do. But that's part of it. That's why you got to study. That's why you got to watch film, and And it really is a process trying to get that together.
So what was it that drew you to NFL in that case? If you're missing the decision-making autonomy?
It was the challenge. I mean, everyone knows the NFL and how, you know, big time it is, how glitz, glamour. For me, it was the frontier of pro sports. You know, it means I could be in a room with, you know, the baddest athletes in the world, and how do you measure up? And for me, you know, the story of going in there, not having even seen, like, I've never been to an American football game before I played in against the Miami Dolphins. I wanted an opportunity to just have my back against the wall and really just see what I was about. You know what I mean? And that's what it was. That's all it was. You know, I never grew up loving the game. You know, I played Madden, watched some of the, you know, the playoff games when it was on, but they were always on at 2 o'clock in the morning. You know what I mean? So there was really no American football to watch when it's not like it is now on Sky with the Red Zone and stuff. It really was the challenge. That was it. I wanted to know, you know, am I the biggest and am I the baddest? You know what I mean? I wanted to go find that out. So that was really it. And then it's kind of turned into something else, and been able to find other aspects of it, you know, like I didn't realize how big the American football community was in England. So to be the first wave of those guys coming through, it kind of made younger people especially think, well, wow, man, well, if these guys can do it, then, you know, maybe I can one day. And that was kind of a huge part of it as well, really, that I didn't think about to begin with, but was really taken aback by that.
That's cool.
Yeah, that is cool.
Blew me way better. Yeah, I like that.
I was just completely sucked in at the moment, so I haven't even thought of any other questions. I'm just like, wow.
A bit of motivation.
Yeah, how did it all come about? I know you came through the international player pathway, but do you see more English rugby stars coming across NFL? Obviously Christian Wade's gone across and Christian Scotland Williamson. So do you see it as a viable pathway for a lot of rugby players or athletes over here?
I think so. I mean, you obviously have to be a special kind of athlete a little bit. I mean, you look at Wadey, there's no question how good an athlete he is. And you look at Christian Scotland Williamson, like he's a huge, huge guy. You know, these are guys that you can't find walking the street everywhere, you know what I mean? So how many guys really do fit into that category? Not many, really. But I think what would really stop guys is I think they would love the idea of it, but when it comes down to having a sitting in a meeting room and learning all this stuff and basically going from, you know, say it was some of the top guys, like I know Anthony Watson, it was thrown about that he would have loved to have a crack at it at some point, whether he might, I don't know. But will he want to come back and be like the bottom rung academy player? Like, and if you need some reference to how you're kind of treated, you need to YouTube Keith Armstrong, Atlanta Falcons, from when he did the Hard Knocks. He was my special teams coach my first 2 years, and I think you'll get an idea of what you're facing every day with the coaches. So I would suggest anyone to YouTube that if they're listening, just to see what an actual meeting can go like.
How does it compare to being in like a Premiership academy?
It's weird though, because there isn't such a hierarchy where there is in rugby, you know? So those young guys coming through, they'll get abused by some of the older guys, especially on team socials. I mean, it's all in good jest. And yes, there is like a big part of character development in there. But the thing is, with the guys who come out of college into the NFL, every one of those guys you're in the room with, wherever they've come from, is the absolute man. You know what I mean? So there's like, there isn't a lot of like banter flying, or you never someone would have a bad day, or you'd be like, oh man, you are shit. You know what I mean? You get a bit of that in rugby, but you know, there's just none of that, because, you know, the guys know how hard it is to be in a locker room. And they know that the difference between maybe them and the guy who's in the practice squad or like the academy type, the distance isn't very far. And if you have a couple of bad days, this guy might take your job and you might be out of the NFL and it's dream over. So you get a little bit as you do with any group, but it's very, very business focused, as I kind of already alluded to.
Yeah, I was going to ask, what's it like with those egos? Because in rugby, I think ever since Kieran Reid took a broom to a changing room, everyone's been banging on about humility. But American football, like American football.
Yeah, let them know, Joe.
Well, American football is just the complete opposite, isn't it? It's egos. No one dials down the charisma. It's like massively bombastic people. What's it like dealing with that in a team environment?
To be honest with you, I think we were pretty good at the Falcons because the head coach used to come and talk to me about that book, about the All Blacks book, how they used to sweep the chain. So he was really into that. He loved the brotherhood feel. So I think me being at the Falcons was the closest I could have got to the rugby. And we didn't really have any divas. Like, we had Julio Jones, the best receiver. He's going to go into the Hall of Fame. He was just a normal guy. You know what I mean? Like, I would have liked to have seen and been around someone like Antonio Brown, or, you know, even when like Chad Ochocinco was playing, like these type of guys who just talk a lot of crap, you know. So it's just we really didn't have a lot of that but you do. The egos are everywhere, but it's also a huge cover up for how insecure a lot of the guys are, because they want to be a football player so bad. It's all they are. And they just know that it could be taken away from them. We're always taught, bring the juice, do this. But what I came to realize was fake juice is real juice. You just can't tell the difference. You know what I mean? So you don't know how a player's feeling because it's just so ingrained for them to be jumping around and like whooping and hollering. But yeah, I enjoyed that part of it because every day, every training session seemed like a celebration. You know what I mean? So I kind of definitely bought into all of that. I enjoyed it. And we were lucky. We didn't have many divas, as they call them. So you get a lot of guys like holding out for contracts and not turning up to training camp because they want more money, all that type of stuff. And I guess it's just that next little bit of professional sport where the players actually have some power. You know what I mean?
You're talking about juice and bigging people up. We got a question from someone. Ask him about his famous England under 16s pre-game speech.
who sent that question in?
He shall remain nameless.
A faithful listener.
I think I must have had a bit of Americanism in me since day one because I gave a speech to the guys about... the strap line was we ride together, we die together. And that was it. Hell yeah, man. So that was it. Back at 16, I had that mantra. So it was, I loved it, you know.
I'll take some notes here for my next team talk, Shag. Keep going.
That's from Marcus.
Yeah, he was there. So on one of the games where they made me captain, I had to do a team talk, and it was the night before the game. And I was literally thinking, what am I going to say here? Like, am I just going to say something, then it just be dead silence, or thanks, Alex, sit out. You know what I mean? But anyway, I just went with what I knew, rugby-esque, just, you know, put some heart and soul into it. And as I finished, there was like an ear of silence, and I sat down, and then a second later, everyone just erupted. Like, because obviously they didn't expect anything like that from like a young rookie, blah blah blah. So that was a very cool moment for sure. Because they just love it. They love the hype, you know. So I thought, you know what? Here we go. Let's just get into it.
That sounds epic.
What's that? Ride or die, Shaggy. What's been like your best moment so far in like the whole scenario, like going moving over and being a massive part of it? What's been your like one standout moment apart from that? That like has been class. And what's been one that's been shit as well? That's a good question.
Yeah. I can't look past the first game I played, like as I was saying, against Miami, because as I said, I'd never been coming back from that, the first training session like I went to, I had never lined up next to anyone. I'd never seen a defense in front of me, and all of a sudden when I first got there, I didn't think I was going to be doing anything. I thought I was going to be watching, just trying to learn. But first day, my position coach was like, all right, you're going in. I was like, okay, chin strap up. Don't know, you know what I mean? So that was crazy. But yeah, the first game where we're at Miami, you know, that's kind of an iconic place to go play with the Dolphins. And just being stood in the tunnel and just thinking, you know, Matt Ryan, MVP, he's earning $30 million a year. And he's saying, he's getting us going. And I'm just thinking, I'm looking around, I've got a pads helmet on. I'm thinking, what am I doing here? Like, what's going on? Like, you know what I mean? And then, but funnily enough, like I wasn't nervous at all, because the way that the NFL is, you study so much. And I always think that preparation leads to confidence. And I had done so much studying and I'd worked so hard to get to this point that I literally was, I had no fear, because I knew I can't do any more. Whatever I know, I know. If I don't know it, then I couldn't have done any more. So I literally, I didn't feel nervous at all. And then once the game started, it was just kind of the same feel as playing. But it's like being, it's like, it's weird because you're on the bench all the time. So you run on and off depending on like player packages.
I know all about that.
No doubt, mate. Don't we all at some point? So yeah, I mean, because depending on which players they need in for which plays and all that type of stuff, you're always running on, running off, looking over to the sideline to see whether you're coming off or not. So yeah, probably that moment in Miami. One of the terrible parts, probably my second training camp. I don't think I have ever been as low as I had. I don't know what it was. I mean, I was just so drained mentally, physically. I had like two or three really bad days and I was thinking, man, I'm not going to be here. And I had to like, and I was talking to some of the older guys. I was like, I have never been in a hole as big as this before. You know what I mean? When it got in my head, I couldn't catch up to that point, I was catching everything. And that was one of my strengths as a player, is I would catch balls all day, every day. And I was just dropping easy passes, missing blocks, doing all this like crazy stuff that I'd worked so hard to be good at. And it just wasn't happening. Messing up calls. My head coach absolutely rinsed me while we were on the sideline in front of everyone. He was like screaming. And I was just thinking, Jesus, man, I'm gone. But I managed to stay around, get a little bit better and just claw myself back. You know, but that hole that I was in. So that was kind of my worst part. But maybe even the back end of that was maybe my best part, you know, the fight back. Because for me, it's more the day to day. Like I said, like the big thing for me was the challenge of it. So just being there and just, could I class myself as elite? You know what I mean? Being there, grinding every day, staying out, catching, working on stuff, being in the ice tubs, like all of that. It gave me the opportunity that I wanted to prove to myself that, yeah, I'm an elite sportsman. You know what I mean?
Man, that's awesome insight. That's so cool. What kind of, like, on the sports side, but also from the kind of the bigger American sports package, like product side, what would you want to bring in from the American sports into rugby, and what do you think would really improve it?
I think the showbiz element. I think that there's so much cultural difference though. Like the Americans, they like flashy, they like big, extravagant, whereas rugby especially, it's kind of lost in its tradition a little bit. And I really think if that doesn't change, then rugby's going to end up dying out, because what happens in 20 years time when all the purists sat in Twickenham die? Like there's no, what is bringing, unless you go to a private school or play club rugby, what is bringing a new wave of people in to rugby? And I just don't think, until you have something that is appealing for every, like the newer generation. I know there's a lot of talk recently, wasn't there, about the chairman, et cetera, et cetera. So I just really hope they do look at how do they glam it up a little bit. And whether that's in, you know, I mean, the Sevens is a prime product of that. You know, they're trying so hard and I wish that would get more backing in that sense. You know, I think I was listening to Ben last week when he was saying about, you know, trying to do the one-off tournaments where it's one evening or whatever. You know, it's hard to do, but you need to pull the product in a little bit, you know, put the fireworks on, make it something people want to watch, change some of the rules maybe. But it's just, and I think the biggest thing is rugby needs to get rid of this shackle of, as you were saying, the humility shackle, which I think is good. You know, you should be hoping for good people, not someone who is always thinking, I can't do this, I can't do that because of what people might think, because that's what that ends up breeding. You know what I mean? So I think that's the main thing. Just an outlooking mindset rather than we're doing what we've done for however many years. We love the tradition. You know, that's fine. Keep that. But how do we add? How do we move it forward now? You know? I mean, yeah, that's kind of it, really. Just a forward-thinking mindset would help.
Yeah, I mean, well, Mitch, you're still playing rugby, obviously. What would you feel about an opposition player who was a bit more egocentric, a bit more brash, and spoke openly positively about how good he was, because as we've all discussed, it's a culture of being very, very humble, but maybe not saying how it is, like stifling of people's characters, their personalities.
It's a tough one, isn't it? Because I jest about how good I am. I think I'm class.
Go on.
You got to back yourself, haven't you?
Now, and like, when you say how good you are, we bring you down a peg or two, but actually we know that we also think you're really good. So it kind of works in this like roundabout way. But
all you have to do is have one compliment and I soak it in. I'm a sponge. I just deflect everything with a got a blue lightsaber.
But there's loads of players out there who I know think that they are the shit, but they'd never say it on camera because they're trained. It's ingrained to be humble and modest. But if you had people coming out saying, do you know what? I looked up and I saw my opposite man and I knew I could burn him. So I just smoked him and it's tries every time. If they came out and said that and you had those big brash characters, do you reckon that's the kind of smack talk that would bring in a younger generation or get tongues wagging a bit more?
I think we're already seeing it, to be honest. I think people are feeling more and more free to express themselves as individuals. It's certainly something that we've tried to encourage, like in our environment, in our team. Like, you want people to be themselves and to be all of themselves, whatever that is. But we're also, I think there's also a big emphasis alongside that of trying to grow as people and understand who we want to be as people. So, you know, there's a big difference between someone who's in their late 20s or 30 or whatever, who understands what it's about and is saying how good they are, versus, you know, when you know what you're like when you're 18, 19 and you think you're the dog's bollocks, but actually you don't realize that, you know, you don't know half the shit you're talking about. You know, there's kind of a bit of a balance there, and I think that balance has been too far, Shaggy said, like you said, that's been too far probably the wrong way and not allowing people to express themselves. So, but I think we're seeing it, like obviously Ellis Genge is a big example who, you know, takes a fair bit of flack for it, but, you know, he's being himself, and I think he probably does a bit more than maybe he would normally because he wants to stir things up a bit. That's the impression I get, and I think that's fair enough.
I think it's what you use it for, isn't it? I mean, if you have put in the work and your team has seen you put in the work day after day, and then you playing is your time, you've worked for that, you know what I mean? This is your moment to go and express yourself. And if you are only using, as we call it, the hype or the whatever, or trash talking or whatever it is, if you are only using that to better yourself and the team, then I don't think there's any problem with that at all. I just think, you know, it gets to the point, as you say, with young kids, but are they trying to be noticed? Are they trying to get more Instagram likes, all that type of stuff? Is it hollow? You know, have they put in the work? That's the real difference, because I know the guys talk all that shit in the NFL because they're trying to impose themselves, they're trying to win the game. You know what I mean? And it does go too far with some guys, but I think most of them are just trying to be there. They're trying to be their absolute best. And to get to that point, you need to be able to take yourself to that level. And if you have to walk around telling your opposite number how good you are and how you're going to run around him, then that's your decision. Like, and if you've put the work in to help your team, as long as it's not detrimenting your team, then I don't know how anyone can pull that back, you know?
Mate, I think you're bang on. And actually, from personal experience, I think I've probably missed out at times in my career from not having that like positive self-talk and kind of for some reason, you know, staying away from that. And I actually think being more open and even if not telling other people, but actually even telling myself more and like, you know, saying it in training, like, fucking hell, that was a nice kickoff. Like, oh, that was a decent step, or whatever it is, or that was a hell of a pass. Like, even just that self-talk can be really powerful. And I think I've probably missed out on that at times in my career, and probably loads of people have, because I don't know where it comes from, probably because you grow up with this kind of idea of like this sort of false modesty or whatever.
Like, I mean, the way I look at it is this, that's you, those are your moments. You know what I mean? You work hard for those moments and how you want to express yourself and how do you want to live your life day to day? Do you want to walk around thinking about how people are going to, you know, react to you? You know, are they going to bring you down? Are you worried about that? Or are you just trying to fucking kill it? You know what I mean? And, I think that is the real difference is how do you want to live your life? And as I bring it back to, you know, everyone talks about the humility and being humble. I would like to have that class of, are you a good person? You know, I'd rather be a good person than someone, you know, oh, he's a real humble guy. You know what I mean? Because that to me has some connotations about, aspirations and all this type of thing. I don't know. Each person is their own. But I would like to be judged on how good a person I was, you know, not what I was doing during the game to try and win a game. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's how we balance that kind of self, the self-confidence, the self-promotion, I guess we're thinking about other people, and that's the crux of it. Like, what language you use is pretty important in that, but how do we encourage each other to be like all of ourselves whilst also, you know, not keeping that vision out, knowing that it's a team sport? And that's kind of exactly what I think you're summing up. You've got pretty good awareness of, particularly probably at the Falcons, it sounds like.
Yeah, I think there was one good moment for me that kind of showed the difference between the two and how people perceive what you were doing in the NFL. So I made a small mistake, wasn't bad at all, didn't affect the play. I come off and I'm stood next to one of the other tight ends. I go, man, I am terrible. Like a complete joke. You know what I mean? Like we would in rugby. Just, I mean, they don't get the sarcastic banter anyway. But I mean, he literally straight face turned to me, put his arm around me on my shoulders, like, man, don't say that. You're doing good. Just keep going. You know what I mean? I was like, well, I was joking, but thanks anyway. You know what I mean? So there is some cultural differences like that, you know?
You definitely, if you'd said that to one of the lads, they'd have just gone, yeah, you're fucking shit.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But there's a time and place for that though as well, no doubt.
I wanted to come back to, you brought up your speech in the changing room, in the locker room. You know, there's the locker room in American sports is quite iconic. I think probably because they let TV cameras in there a lot earlier than they have done in UK sport. Can you tell us a bit more about the ritual and the weirdness that goes on in there, like the epic speeches,
crocodiles in showers?
After a win, definitely. There's guys, you know, the rap music on, guys are dancing and hollering and whooping, and the coaches are in it on it as well. The coaches love it, man. Like, it's so hard to get a win in the NFL that whenever we, like, the difference between winning and losing games in the vibe is just crazy. Like, there's no consistency whatsoever. So to be part of those winning locker rooms, you know, is really, really good. I would say that maybe something that's a little bit different to most change rooms in rugby is the US is a very religious country. So they have stuff like what they call shower power, where they'll have a priest come in and take all the religious guys into the shower and say a big prayer before the game. And then the guys who aren't believers are all sat around, known as the dark side and all that type of stuff. And then after the game, after the game, everyone gets on a knee, hold hands, says a prayer together, which is kind of cool, you know. Like, obviously doesn't mean a lot to some people, but it's all in one. But yeah, I mean, some of the locker room stuff after a win, you know, is pretty cool. Yeah.
We should probably talk about a bit of sevens, guys.
I was just going to say, we'll bring it back. I think this is super interesting. We could talk to you all day about it because it's obviously amazing insight for us who have never experienced it. But right, coming back to sevens then, like, what were some of your favorite things about the game? Like, some good memories you had playing for England?
I think one of the biggest things has to be the travel. You know what I mean? Like, it wasn't really until I left that I was sat just dying at Yorkshire Carnegie in the championship that I was thinking, man, what I would give to be back in Cape Town right now. You know what I mean? I just think, you know, those moments, you know, like with the sevens, I got to stand on top of, you know, Table Mountain in Cape Town. I had to go helicopter ride into the Grand Canyon and had lunch down there with some of the boys. The sunset in Dubai, it was just, you know, the Sydney Opera, like everything. And then, you know, you go to these places, and especially in those first couple of years, those tournaments were packed. You know what I mean? You're playing in front of 80,000. And I mean, I love the game of sevens because, as you say, it's just a bit more free flowing. There's less structure. It's just enjoyable, just throwing the ball around. It's a pure rugby to me. And just being away with the guys, you know what I mean? In these amazing places, because, you know, when I got to the NFL, I was talking to a lot of the 75% of Americans don't have passports or anything. And they were like, oh, so where have you played rugby? I was like, well, the team I used to play for, we used to go to New Zealand, Australia, South Africa, Dubai, Hong Kong, France. And they were like, oh, I was like, and we did that every year. You know what I mean? It's just, it's when you think about it, it is really crazy. And it is, and that side of it is a huge privilege. Definitely.
You know, it sounds like you got a fair bit of longing for it. Would you ever come back to rugby, to sevens, to the game?
It'd have to be the right kind of deal. Like I always made the joke, I'm not sure if they could afford me now. But
Jerry Maguire, we were chatting about this before you got on. You're coming in, Jerry Maguire. Yeah. Show me the money.
Yeah, I mean, there is that part of it, but it would have to be the right deal. It would have to give me a shot at. I mean, the two shots I would want is what could set me up for one, maybe the Olympics, and two, the England senior team. You know what I mean? It would have to be something that I would want to be. I would want to be having a chance to fight at the top level. You know what I mean? I would never go back to the champ. I wouldn't do that. It would just have to be the right opportunity because it's so much to sacrifice. You know, the NFL is a great, as hard as it is a great place to be. And you get all sorts of other stuff with that. But you know, rugby has always been my first love. And you know, I never got to represent the senior team, yet. So we'll just see. I mean, we'll see what comes through, but it would have to be a good deal with, and things would have to match up for sure.
It'd be class to have you back, Shaggy. You're welcome.
Yeah, money team, baby.
Money team.
To say, Chippy, one thing I do regret is not us having a good celebration. Because we always had the lightsaber celebration planned out. We had a load of stuff planned out. We never got to. I was probably too hanging to come and catch you up, probably. So
Chippy never scored any tries.
I think they didn't want the two oiliest blokes on the pitch at the same time. There's like a world rugby rule.
Yeah, something about that. Too much oil.
Too much oil
on the road.
Shag, what, did you get a chance to think about who you'd take over from the NFL to sevens? Who would slot in well?
Yeah, I've got a list here.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's what we love to
see. The man's a professional, you can tell.
Yes, Shaggy.
Yeah, I try to make... I mean, this is my life now. Filling out notebooks is my day-to-day. So so basically, I try to do it as viewer-friendly as possible because I'm sure there's a lot of people out there who wouldn't know who the players are. So I try to keep the big names in there and where I thought they'd fit. So for the props and the hooker, so George Kittle, he was just in the Super Bowl. He's a tight end. So I had to give some tight end, you know, that tight end brother love, you know. Number two is Luke Kuechly from the Panthers. He's actually just retired, but he's kind of renowned as he's like the middle linebacker. Just a workhorse, you know, tackles everything. And I thought, you know, that's got to be a hooker in the sevens game. Three has got to be a fan favorite, Gronkowski from the top rope.
Loves the party.
Yeah. So he'd be great after, you know, Hong Kong, Dubai, Cape Town. He'd be great to bring along for sure. And obviously, great big man target for the kickoffs. Number four, the scrum half, I actually went for Antonio Brown just because I would love to see his diva personality in action. And he is a hell of a player as well. So small, fast, great skills. Number five, Lamar Jackson. So the quarterback from the Ravens. Boy can run. You know, could be playing wide receiver. So you could put him on the wing if you needed. Obviously can pull the strings as well playing quarterback. Player called Tyreek Hill who in the centers, he's known as the cheetah, fastest guy in the NFL, they think. And then obviously I had to go with my guy, my locker room buddy, Julio Jones on the wing, because he is he hands down is the freakiest athlete I've ever seen. Just how big, how fast, like how quickly he can stop on a dime. A little bit like Nort if Nort was 20 kilograms heavier and 5 inches bigger.
God, that'd be
good. You know what I'm saying?
Nort doesn't need 5 inches, I'll tell you that. Yeah.
And then I did have a bench, so I had a couple of guys. I'll just read a couple of them off. I had Russell Wilson backing up the 10 and 9 spot. JJ Watt as one of the props.
Nice.
You know, he could come in and cause some damage. I actually only have two defensive players, so you better hope that this team has the ball. Otherwise, it could be just a shootout for most tries. Marshawn Lynch, I put on the beast mode. I put on the bench. He could play anywhere. Could play prop, hooker, center, wing. And then 12, Chad Ochocinco, basically just for his chat. So,
good squad player.
Like it.
Yeah.
Mate, that is epic. Yeah, so you just have to teach someone to do the drop kicks, and that would be an epic team.
Yeah. That's what I think. I thought, who could... that's the problem. We're just going to have to go tries. We're just... Nah, no conversion, please, ref. Just let's get on with it.
Who was it that got you the secret Santa? Was that the Julio Jones?
No, Matt Ryan.
Tell everyone about that. You told me, but tell Mitch and Burnsy.
Yeah, so I mean, obviously, Secret Santa, you're in rugby and you're thinking, 10 quid, 20 quid, maybe. I had no idea, but we turned up one day and there's just this huge, massive barbecue set. That's just... So he basically bought barbecue sets for all the tight ends and all the offensive line to say thank you for blocking, basically. And then you're Googling online and this, I'm thinking, what the hell is this? And then Google online and things worth like $3,000. And he must have bought that. He must have bought that for like, I don't know, 20 people. And then the year after, he bought us like a VIP experience at like the Porsche headquarters. Where you get to drive a Porsche around the track, and that was like $700 per person.
What did you get, Shag?
Just a handshake saying thank you.
Those are handshakes. That'd be more appropriate.
Yeah. But there's some horror stories because we were pretty good in the tight end room. Like the older guys never made us buy anything. We had to take the guys out for dinner, but that was it. But the one of the offensive linemen that I'm good friends with, when he first got in, this is how crazy America is. They made him, for him and his position group, he had to go and buy 15 rifles for the boys, like a rifle each, costing $15,000. Cheers.
Jesus, mate.
And I think they all went on a big hunting trip, you know what I mean? So it's just different life, mate. I mean, you'll enjoy this. I actually sit on Billionaire's Row, I call it. So like next to me, there's like Keanu Neal, first round draft pick, Devontae Freeman, like $50 million over 4 years, Julio Jones, like all these guys are on my row, like a row of four. So I'm always hearing their conversations and they're talking to each other. It's like, Devontae was asking Julio, oh, how much do you get on like appearances? And he's like, man, I don't leave the house for less than $50,000. You know what I mean? This guy is just raking it in.
I've got one from a super fan asking, who could win in a fight between you and Bob Casey?
Well, look, if you take into account, would I be actually looking at the guy when I have to fight him? Or is that, you know what, the stipulation of the rules, can I not look at him? God, man. Welcome to pro rugby, isn't it? But
is there a story there between you and Big Bob?
Have you not? Well, there's a video going around that you guys will have to probably source of me just... all right, the story goes, we were doing like a mauling practice and me and him are on the same team. And we both get pulled out of the maul by one of the opposition players. And he'd been injured for a long time, wasn't playing, so frustrated. And this guy's like a dinosaur. He's like huge, huge man, 20, 22 stone, 6'7". Chippy will know, 22 stone. Yeah,
big boy.
Big boy. So we're both getting pulled out. I only saw this on the video afterwards, but as I'm heading back into the mall, all I feel is boom on the chin. I fall down and I'm thinking, I think, man, he must have caught me with an elbow or something. Anyway, I come back to look at the video. He's just flailing his arms. I run past him back into the mall. He just looks at me and just haymakers me straight in the chin. Like straight arm swing, straight bang on the chin.
Same team.
Yeah, same team. Thanks, mate. Friendly fire. But, you know, I was down but not out. That's the main thing.
That is an amazing video. And I hope everyone sees that at some point. Do you get any scraps in training in the NFL? Do you get any like inter-team scraps?
Yeah, you do get a little bit. I mean, they're really, really hot on it because obviously some of those guys are the coaches hate it because, you know, some of those guys are worth a lot of money to the franchise. So you get sent out of practice. If there's a fight, you'll get broken up and you two will have to go and hit the showers. You know what I mean? But yeah, there's a couple because
it's such a confrontational sport because, especially the position I play, you're on the front line. It is literally you versus another person, and you're having a wrestle with them. Like, you know what I mean? And it's just, you know, there's a little bit of pushing after, blah blah blah. Next thing you know, everyone's grabbing each other's face mask, they're trying to uppercut each other. Yeah, I mean, I kind of find it crazy when guys try and tee off on each other and they're wearing the helmets. I'm thinking, you guys are just, you're going to break your hand. So try knocking a guy out with one of those helmets on, please. You know what I mean?
Yeah, ridiculous. I was just thinking that. What are you going to do? Punch him in the quad or something? Haven't you got pads on your quads as well?
Yeah, you get a bit. I was told by one of the old linemen that the key is to take control of the face mask. Because if you've got your control of the face mask, you can move his head where you need it and try and get an uppercut in, under there and stuff. So that's the only way you're gonna hit someone is like that. So
take control of the face mask. Shaggy, how does the athleticism of the players you're surrounded by now weigh up to the best sevens players that you've played with and against?
I mean, some of those top speed guys. The problem is with it, like if you look at someone like Tui Sova, who is like a freak of a rugby player, there's nowhere for him to play in American football because he's not quite big enough. He's not quite fast enough to fit any one position, you know. So there's a lot of guys in rugby who are like really good athletes, but they're just not good enough at one thing to take him into that over that edge. Like he's not like he. You say like there's a lot of like big fast guys, but are they tall enough? Like it comes down to that because they look at wingspan, hand size, all this type of stuff. But the thing is with the NFL, there's like everyone in the NFL is a good athlete. Like even the big boys up front, they'd all run like the defensive line who might be 150 kilograms. They'd run a 12-second 100 meter, every one of them. So it's just. There's that base level, and then you have a couple of guys who are just different, you know, like Julio Jones is one that I've seen up close and personal. Because every team has them. It's all the first round draft picks, you know what I mean? These guys who can jump 40 inches, run like a 4.3 in a 120 kegs. Whereas in rugby, there's probably still some guys floating around where you're thinking, man, how are you a professional athlete? You know what I mean? Especially in the 15s game.
So are there any sevens guys you used to play against? I know this is going back a few years, but any sevens guys you play against you were like really respected as an athlete?
I liked Akira Ione. He was probably the only one that I kind of thought, I never rated anybody. Anyone we played against, I just never rated anybody. You know what I mean? That's just how I was. And still am to it, but like I thought he was he's something I hadn't seen before in sevens, you know what I mean, or in 15s. I thought he was, you know, he's a really good athlete. And there are some guys like Victor Vito, I think would have been a really good NFL player if he'd started young. There is a handful of guys who you think could have done it, you know, those really athletic back rowers, probably not the second row, but yeah, some of those big athletic back rowers could have maybe done it, you know, played tight end or linebacker. But yeah, Akira Ione was one. Obviously, some of the guys on the circuit are so fast, though. You know, the two American boys, Sinatla, Nortz. You know, I think speed is the most. That's the best thing to look at, isn't it? That's what everyone is wowed by. You know, so that's like the moneymaker, isn't it? The speed. It's just hard to get the combination of speed and the size because that's what you get in the NFL. You get guys who can run 10-second 100 meters, but they're also, you know, 100 kegs. You know.
Shaq, so you've obviously done a lot of work. Is it Sam Portland you work with?
Yeah, shout out Sam Portland, big yes. Red.
So you've done a lot of work with him.
That's where we met, Shaggy.
Yeah, I know, man. That was down at Richmond.
Did speed work together.
Speed work. Jesus, he needs a speed work as well, Shaggy. Did it?
he was too busy checking out Kirsty Gallagher's see-through leggings, man. That's his problem.
Oh, rattled.
Yes. I'm not in a position to deny that.
Shaq, what are you weighing in at now? Because you're shifting. I've seen some videos of you shifting some tin and you're looking big and quick. What are you weighing at now compared to where you were at sevens? I know you're quicker.
I'm hovering at around 115. I'm definitely faster. I mean, obviously not having to do as much as cardio, fitness, like that slow burn stuff. It really is. Everything's so twitchy in American football. It's like lights on, lights off. You know what I mean? It's stop, start, go. Like, and everything is 100%. And my training has obviously replicated that. So yeah, kind of up at 100, 115, you know, around about there. And I'm hitting 10 meters per second, on a longer sprint. So that's like that's faster than I've ever been. That's kind of, I think that's parallel to maybe some of the 15 wingers, you know. So yeah, I feel good, you know. It's, and the thing is with the long off seasons, you have a lot of time to, as long as you use that time effectively, you have a lot of opportunity to get better at stuff. And that's what I did, you know. And I was joking, shout out to Sam Portland, but if anyone does need some training, I can't recommend him highly enough, because he has really, really helped me on my journey, and kind of helped me discover an athleticism that I didn't, you know. I've always been a good athlete, you know, always since growing up, but I didn't realize where I could get to if you sorted out some links in the chain and really, really did that, you know. So, yeah, I'm really thankful for his help and for just being able to put the work in with him, you know.
Is there anyone else who like not like to give a shout out to, but who's helped you along your journey in the NFL? Who's like kind of put an arm around you, or like boosted you, or given or pointed out something you hadn't thought about before?
Yeah, I mean, there's one player that no one will ever hear about, but he's played 10 years in the NFL, like real big journeyman because of how good a person he is and how good he is at bringing guys through. And it was probably the first time in my life that I ever had a mentor. Like a type of mentor, and now that I've seen that, because you know, he has shown me some ways of how to be a great teammate that I didn't really know before. And you know, if I was going to be ultra critical of myself, especially when I was back at the Sevens, I was so singular focused on trying to do what I wanted to do, that I probably wasn't the best teammate when I could have been. You know, because obviously, I had a stellar background coming into the Sevens. You know. was probably one of the key performers, like along with you guys, and I really now see how much more I could have done with the group, and it wasn't, if I'd never met him and had his constant work and help and arm around the shoulder, and I moved in with him in the off season just so he could teach me football, and he would, and one of his goals for him, he said to me face to face, was I want to see you on this team. Like, I want to see you making it in the NFL. And for someone who himself has been kicked around the league and is trying to feed his family, you know, that was just a huge thing for me, because I'd seen how dog eat dog it was. And for him to say those words to me and truly, truly mean them, you know, that was huge. And, you know, I'm forever grateful for him. So Logan Paulson, if you ever see, he's not on Twitter, he's not on Instagram, he's an old school bloke, but, I do appreciate you and thank you for all your help, my man.
Nice.
You're gonna have to cut this up for me so I can send it to him, because he won't see it otherwise.
Yeah. We'll send you a copy.
He's not listening to the Seventh Heaven podcast. I can't believe that.
This is why I'm on, man. I'm trying to get you guys worldwide. Let's do this.
Yeah, boy.
Look, I want to ask one last question about athleticism. And I don't know if this is a pod exclusive, but it certainly hasn't been widely marketed in the media. But England's Sevens are looking to do a combine next year. So they signed up with a partnership with Red Bull. They're trying to take Seven to the next level, and they're going to be doing a combine style where they get athletes from different sports, freak athletes from different sports, to come and do pretty much all the tests that the NFL do. And they're also, I think they're going to, you guys might be able to tell me better than this, they're going to get the current England team to do those tests as well as a benchmark. How do you reckon that's going to go, Shaggy? Do you think that's a good idea?
I think so. I mean, you know who's the baddest, who's the fastest, who's the strong. Well, I mean, you can't do that. How many reps of 100? I don't think is a very valid test. But yeah, it'd be good to see on paper where these guys are at. I mean, it's a little different for rugby because there is such a skill component to it, far, far, far more than there is in American football. But yeah, I think it'd be a good idea to see where you are, you know, and could you then take a guy who has, you know, outstanding measurables, and how good is the coaching? You know, how good can you take these guys and produce them into a? Because you see a lot of guys who, especially sprinters, all this type of stuff, who they have all these attributes, and they just fall to the wayside because no one can upskill them. You know, how it's going to be great to see, are the coaches capable of doing that? But I think it'd be great to get stuff on paper. See who's the fastest. See who's the, you know, who can jump the highest, and then you can compare yourself to other. You know, I'm sure other nations will want to get in on that, and then it'll just, you know, you'll know what type of players you need, who is the best and stuff. So I think it's a good idea. Great for publicity, no doubt. And that's just, as you say, that's one of those things we were talking about, trying to showbiz it a little bit. You know, So yeah, I think it's a good idea. It'd be interesting to see what the scores are.
I'm with you, Shaggy. I think it's a great idea.
Yeah. So what next for you, Shaggy? You're an undrafted free agent. So does that mean you're not going to be training with the Falcons? You're going to be training on your own? How does it work? And what's the plan for you when we get back from lockdown?
It's basically, I've had some interest from teams already, but it's just a case of, oh, you're not in America. I couldn't even go see them anything. So it's just, there's a lot of guys on the free market right now. There's a lot of starters who don't have positions right now because of this coronavirus. Because guys, I said, you can't go in for medicals. They don't know if people are healthy. It really is the wild, wild west right now. So it's just a case of, I did well with the opportunities I had. I've got some good film out there. I've got some measurables that are pretty good that teams like. So we'll see. I've literally just waiting to see what happens. That's kind of the feedback I've had from people and stuff. So once the borders open up and I can actually, because I actually need to get another visa. My 3-year visa ran out, so that's another hurdle I have to get over. So pray for me, boys.
Mate, it's been so interesting hearing about it. Like, amazing insight into what is a pretty crazy world that you're living in. So thanks very much for sharing that with us. It's awesome.
No problem. No, thanks for having me. It's been good fun.
Loved it.
As I said, it's a bit weird me not being naked right now, but that's...
Next time, Shaggy. Next time. Hey, thanks, Shaggy. Absolutely love that, pal.
One night in heaven. I'm going to throw it out there, boys. Best interview of the pod so far. I loved that.
No, it was class having him on. Really insightful, and really the way he spoke about the NFL was class. Obviously, he mentioned to us a bit off air about this is the first kind of interview he's done since being a free agent, so he could actually like express his feelings on how stuff is. And just good to get that out there, I think. The top boy, like, always been one of the hardest working players I've met. And you can see why he's done well in the NFL so far. And I wish me and Mitch, and wish him all the best for the future. I'm sure he'll land on his feet. Always does, works hard.
It was an amazingly open account, wasn't it, of his journey. It's really cool, like, just being party to that kind of openness. He was brilliant. Really enjoyed that.
Do you know what really struck me is how clinical he is in his decision-making process? He obviously loves sport, but that... he doesn't hang too much on the romanticism of it. He's in the NFL to be competing at the top, not necessarily because he loves the style of the game. I thought that was quite interesting. That's not a side that you see to a lot of sportsmen in England.
He's always been ruthless with everything. So, like, example, he said about not being a great teammate when he was at Sevens. We'd wait for him constantly to start sessions because he was doing his pre-ab. If he had a little niggle, he'd be on it. It'd be like, he'd spend 20 minutes before a session. We're like, all everyone's warmed up, ready to go. And the coaches would be like, oh, Shaggy, are you ready to train? Because he'd be like, nah, I'm warming this up. Like, you can't make me train until I'm ready. And he's ruthless about getting the best out of himself to give the best for the team. So seeing him take to the NFL is like seeing a duck take to water. You know what I mean? Like, it's easy for him to go in where everyone wants to be the best, and he has to perform the best because he's been doing it for years. Like, he's one of the hardest working blokes on and off field that you can meet.
It was really interesting that he picked out that learning about how to be a better teammate from being in an environment which is probably even more focused around the individual.
Yeah. When he said it, I thought, well, yeah, like, there was points of Shag that you would have changed when he was at the Sevens, but that's just the growth and development as a person.
Hell of a player when he was wearing the England Sevens jersey. It'd be nice to have him back in the mix at some stage, wouldn't it?
Yeah, the great thing about playing with Shag was that he would come out with some offloads, some feet, some moves that were totally unexpected for a guy of his stature as well. I think he was so light-footed for a guy of his stature, and lovely kind of silky hands and offloading ability. So you knew that he could create something out of nothing. And there were real moments of brilliance. And I'm not surprised that his highlights reel grabbed the attention of the NFL selectors, because it's pretty sweet.
That's it. He's just a silky bloke, isn't he? Like, for someone so big with the skills he's got and his footwork, the ability to stop and go and change. For a big bloke, he moves bloody well, doesn't he?
Right. I think that's us, boys, for the NFL special in the bag.
Lovely stuff.
Yeah, really enjoyed it, Burnsy. Good to see you again. Mitch, looking sharp. Burnsy, have a shave. See you all next week.
Get on you, boys.
Right, so that's it for another episode of Seventh Heaven. We thank you for your listenership and we're feeling the love with the ratings and the numbers at the moment. So if you could keep that up and rate us 5 stars on iTunes, Acast, Spotify, YouTube, wherever you get your podcasting fix, then that would be absolutely terrific. But from all of us up in the clouds in Seventh Heaven, until next time, it is adios.
See you.
Laters.